Oh, hey, I'm Coco, and welcome to our talk show, Single and Too Tired to Mingle. We'll be talking about relationships with ourselves, our exes, our kids, and other important beings. So stay tuned. Liz Brewer, welcome to Tuesday Talks.
Coco, I'm delighted to be here.
Amazing. Thank you for being my guest. You are known for so many things, and we're going to try to cover some of them today.
Good luck.
We're going to start from quite the beginning, and then we'll see where we end up. So, was it 18 that you kind of ran away from home?
Much younger? Yeah, I was a debutante. And they don't have this sort of thing nowadays. Mm-hmm. Being a debutante in the days when I grew up was like an arranged marriage.
Right.
And what happened was, in January and February, the girls who were going to do the season, it would be announced, and there was a woman called Betty Kenwood, and she was one of the significant contributors to Queen magazine. Right. So Harper's and Queen, but then it was Queen. And she made contact with you. She told you when you could have your coming out dance. Okay. She told you that date is free or that one. It was quite rigid. And so January, February, the girls would get together and they had tea parties. Right. And they would sit on the floor having their tea, and they'd exchange names and addresses, whether they had any brothers, whether they had any cousins, right, whatever. At the same time, the mothers got together and they had the Deb's mum's luncheons, and the mothers would sit there and they'd say, do you have any nephews? Do you have any sons? You know, and this sort of exchange of information. Right. That's why I'm saying it was like arranged marriage. Continued until through March, April, and April the 1st, the cocktails started.
Right.
And so the cocktail parties were when the girls would get together, by which time you'd met every girl that was coming out doing the season.
Age what?
Oh, they normally would be 17, okay. 18, 17, 18. Because I had been expelled from the last two schools I was at, I was sort of slightly earlier than
Why were you expelled, Liz?
If we start going into all that, all I can tell you is when I wrote my first book, yeah, I do remember one of my old school friends called me and said, Liz, you do realise you've got huge spread in the Queen's College, Harley Street, mm-hmm, and the Queen's magazine. I said, I have. So being polite, mm-hmm, I rang up and I spoke to the headmistress. I said, you know, it's Liz Brewer, you know, and then at that time it was Elizabeth Brewer. Mm-hmm. And I said, I want to thank you for this wonderful review done on my first book. So it would have been the millennium. And she said, we're rather surprised. You never visit the school. And I said, pause. I was expelled.
Did I forget?
And then there was another pause, and she said, all the more reason to come and talk to the girls.
Oh, wow.
So it was quite funny. Yeah, forward thinking.
So,
if I start getting into all that, we'll go back and back and back. But what I did, so we had the cocktail parties. By the time the dances start, which would have been with Queen Charlotte's Ball, when traditionally you would have been presented at court to the Queen at that time.
Right.
And I wasn't that old, so I'm not that old, so I wasn't presented. But it was the tail end of when we still had proper coming out dances. We still had the Queen Charlotte Ball, and you all wore white dresses, and it wasn't a charity event. It was an event that you invited to, your parents went, maybe your godparents. And then the ball started. And mine was, that was 14th of May, mine was the first dance of the season. And every single night there was a coming out dance, and at the weekends there would be house parties, and there'd probably be a dance on the Friday and maybe on the Saturday. And they could be anywhere all over the country. Mm. It was an extraordinary experience. And of course it forced you into being put into a situation where night after night you'd be sitting next to people you'd never seen in your life, often a lot older than you, far more sophisticated. And it quite a terrifying experience, but you quickly got, I enjoyed it.
Yeah.
I was one of the few girls I loved it.
It's probably not for everyone. No, but yeah, if you love it, I'm sure it's amazing.
And I love
yeah.
the house party weekends, and you stay in some of the grandest houses in this country. And they were fabulous. So having done that, the whole idea is by August, you go down to Cowes and the Royal Yacht would come in and there'd be the Squadron Ball, the Cowes Corinthian Ball. There'd be wonderful balls which the girls would go to. And then you'd go up to Scotland and you'd take in the Scottish season. And you do again, you're put into house parties with people you probably never met. And you do that, and at the end of that time, you are supposed to have found a suitable young man to get engaged to and obviously marry. I had decided that by that time, I was so fascinated with the world, and I wanted to be part of the world. I wanted to get out there and do something. I didn't just want to end up as her indoors with park gates. It would have been lovely. You know, my life would have been very easy, but I just wanted to be part of the world. So it was not my parents' idea. And so
they had a different idea putting it through
this. Yeah, absolutely. And I'd done all the courses. So I'd done a domestic science course. Yeah. I'd been forced to do a secretarial course. I had to have a private tutor because I didn't want to do it, but thank goodness I did. Mm. So I can touch type, and which was very useful when we didn't have, you know, screens to talk into and it would do the words for us. So I had all that, and I did flower arranging at Constance Spry, and the domestic side, I knew how to make a bed and do your envelopes, you know, corners.
Yeah,
so all that business. And then I decided, no, the Portuguese government were publicising the fact that the Algarve, which is southern
stunning,
part of it, they were going to turn it into tourism.
Right.
At that time, it was barren. There were Moorish houses. It were mainly fishermen. And you couldn't even buy a bicycle in Portugal in those days.
Okay.
They really dealt in wine. And I nearly said inferior red wine, but it wasn't to my taste.
Yeah.
And cork.
Yeah.
And anyway, so I was reading all this. They were going to loan you money at 2% if you did anything in the interest of tourism. I thought, great, well, a nightclub. And I met a young man who's actually still around. He was my second ex-fiancé. He was Sapphire and Diamonds.
And we're going to get to your fiancés in a moment.
Never. And he wanted to open, because he was the one that alerted me to all this, and he wanted to open a luxury hotel. Unfortunately, as far as the Portuguese were concerned, a luxury hotel had to have 700 beds plus.
Ooh, okay.
He wanted to do something small, so it didn't sort of work out, but we got together. And it's such a long story, but what happened was I did end up, believe it or not, arriving in the Algarve, having gone to stay with my first ex-fiancé, gone to San Fermín, watched the bulls run through the streets, their bulls were fighting, forced to go and watch the slaughter behind the scenes where I collapsed. And then by that particular fiancé, shown the hill where we were going to be living, and he's going to build our home. And I said, no, that's not the idea.
Mm.
We were going to live in Paris or London. We were not going to live here on a hill.
So was the fiancé Portuguese or was he English?
And also, it was so old fashioned. I mean, I wasn't allowed to hold hands.
Yeah.
And if we went to swimming at the tennis club, there was a swimming pool for the men, a swimming pool for women. You were segregated the entire time. Broke my heart. So he was one of the first, and the second was
Neville. So why don't you walk us through your fiancés?
So they'll come up.
They'll come up as we go along.
So I thought, right, I'm going from here, which was Milagro, where they had tobacco. Having done Pamplona, I went to Milagro, where they had tobacco plantations. Then he drove me to Madrid. And with tears, he said he was sorry, but I said, it's too late. And I caught the train to Madrid, where, believe it or not, I hired a car with a provisional license.
Right.
And which you could do in those days, yeah. Nobody would have realized a provisional license was not a driving license.
Was it a British license or was
it was a provisional British license.
Okay.
And I drove 400 bends through the Alentejo to the south. And I always remember my first view as I hit, the Portuguese had built one main road from one side of the Algarve to the other. And I hit this road and there was a road straight ahead. And you could see, as I drove along, the headline, you know, one sort of hill going there, another there, and there was the sea behind and a church steeple and this moon shining down. And I thought, that's where I'm going to live. And I just drove. And pure luck, because I didn't even speak Portuguese. And I ended up in this little fishing village on the cobble street called Albufeira. Mm-hmm. And nobody had heard of Albufeira.
Yeah.
And there was a little cafe, so it may have been 10 o'clock. Again, pure luck, I happened to chance come across a man called Juan Bailot, who'd married a Swedish woman, and he spoke English. Okay. And he had a passport because he was a famous artist.
Right.
And it must have been extraordinary to see this young girl, I mean, I was so young, and say, well, I've come here, I'm going to buy a property and I'm going to open the first discotheque club in Portugal.
How did you come up with the discotheque?
Oh, well, they'd opened, the first three had opened in London, the Saddle Room, the Garrison, and the discotheque. I just thought it was the best thing ever. I mean, you have to understand, I love dancing.
Right.
I mean, I love dancing.
Okay.
I really do. I lose myself in music and dancing. So the idea, and at that time, you know, they had strobe lights, they had turntables, they had the top 10, they had long paying records, and they had fabulous music.
Yeah.
I'm not sure I could dance to today's music, because the music in those days absolutely sort of pushed you onto the dance floor. It was so wonderful. So yeah, I was shown various properties, and I said, right, well, I'm now going to go back and I will fly. I had a friend with a plane.
Right.
And that's a whole other story, because I was learning to fly.
Okay.
Till I ended up in the bar, smashed through the bar of the flying club at Margate. I was banned from flying. But I ended up at the bar and I said, vodka tonic, please.
Before you were going to go and fly
No, the plane was in the bar. The plane, I was with an instructor,
right.
And instead of putting my foot on the brake, I put it on the accelerator. He had dual controls.
Yeah.
He could have stopped it or something, but maybe he couldn't believe what was happening. And we ended up in the bar. Which is when I asked for a vodka and tonic. And so that was it.
So that was the end of your pilot career.
But the friend of mine who had his own plane. So I went back. I had the money in a carrier bag to buy the property. And well, then I'll then skip forward, because I had so much publicity, which I've kept.
Okay.
And I kept everything. Don't ask me why, but I kept everything. Every invitation I've ever had, the thank you letters balls, the even the Deb's mum's luncheons. I got everything.
Wow.
And albums, 210 of them. And having done that, I met Lulu. I met, Elton John. I met one of the guys used to come and supply me with the records. Literally, little Scotsman. And he plugged records for a company called Polydor. And so he'd come and stay three or four times a year, and bring records. And it wasn't until after I closed the club, because it was a revolution, and I came back to this country. My brother is quite significant in making movies of the great musicians of the world, B.B. King, Nat King Cole, Sammy Davis Jr., all those. And I went with him to L.A., to Elton John's house, and he was discussing a deal. And I'm looking around, and when they came out, I said, who's the guy in these photographs? And they said, well, you don't know him. He's called John Reed. I said, if the guy in the photograph's called John Reed, I know John Reed, because he was the guy that ended up having to share a bed with my chef de musica, Jane Mary Masters. And he was the guy that smuggled all my records into Portugal.
No.
And he was in New York at the time, but he owned the villa,
right,
because John Reed Enterprises, you probably don't know, but they had a huge court case between John Reed Enterprises, and who managed Elton John.
Right.
And Elton, and sadly for Elton, he lost. And so little John Reed, he was in New York, so they rang him and they said, there's a girl here who says she knows it. And John, and I'd lost him and he'd lost me. Right. And I said, well, John, haven't you done well? You can imagine. And so we linked up, we got together.
Nice.
And he was, and to this day, a great friend of mine. And if you ever watch Rocket Man, mm-hmm, it's all about John Reed and Elton John. And so at that time, I mean, the people I met were, a lot of them were beginning but successful in showbiz. And because we had so much publicity, they came down. So I left that, so that literally when I came back to this country, I started a company to do British Transport Hotels, was one of the biggest hotel companies in UK. And they had Glen Eagles, Tregenna Castle, they owned King's Cross, they owned 33 fabulous hotels. And so I went to stay at one with my family for Christmas and complained because there's nothing for young people.
Yeah.
And they were sensible enough to haul me in to St. Pancras Chambers, mm-hmm, and say, well, perhaps you'd like to be a consultant and advise us what to do. So I did, and opened disco bars and health bars and discotheques in many of their hotels.
Okay.
And so that escalated me into in London, where I had bought by that time my first property in London, a one room kitchen bathroom in Pelham Court, opposite Pelham Crescent, mm-hmm, in Chelsea, which I did up. And then sold 2 years later, trebled my money, and then bought another, and until eventually I ended up here. And I always remember at the time being approached by so many companies who then wanted to open these discotheque clubs.
Right.
So there was one called Wedges in the King's Road. I don't even know if it's still there. It was a whole series of them. So I got involved with what, in fact, the original owner of Annabelle's did, Mark Burley, who was a good friend of mine. And he put together a committee of sort of 10 or 12 sort of well-connected people. And each one was allowed to have 10 honorary members and suggest 100 potential members.
Okay.
So I copied that. I thought it was a brilliant idea. I told him I was copying it. And at the time, we were traveling together down to the Algarve because he was being asked to open a club. He'd opened Annabelle's, and he had Annabelle's and Harry's Bar at that time. Don't think he'd open Mark's. And he was being used to open a club at this particular very expensive sort of resort. And Quinta del Lago. And it was at that time that I said to him, well, I'm going to copy what you're doing and I'm going to do it in London. He didn't mind. And that's exactly what I did.
Mm.
So I got involved then with launching all these clubs. And it was a period of about 10 years, I suppose. And I then think I had Sapphire and Diamonds, and then there was Sapphire and Diamonds, and there was Ruby and Diamonds twice, and then there was, oh God.
You're talking about your fiancé, isn't
it? I know.
Are you reminiscing?
I'm trying to think which ones were around, but it's sort of...
Why don't you walk us through how you got these fiancés? I'm very curious.
Yeah. I remember one saying to me that I had childbearing hips.
Oh, wow.
And I wasn't quite sure
what
that meant. I mean, I was always about a stone heavier, so I was cuddly.
Right.
I was cuddly. And but I do remember, you know, my mother used to say, it's the greatest compliment a man can pay you. So I always said yes, because you could hardly say no if a man pays you the ultimate compliment. Mm. And so I used to say yes, but the trouble was, you know, I'd be engaged and then I'd meet somebody else.
Yeah, that's a problem.
And so, yeah, there were three at one time. And
changing. Three at once, you mean?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
And there was, well, there was ruby and diamond, sapphire and diamonds, and diamond and gold. And I remember with the sapphire and diamonds, I hadn't got the heart to tell him that I'd moved on to ruby and diamonds.
Oh, no.
And so I would go and have lunch or whatever, and then I'd remember to change the rings. And one time I was leaving I was leaving ruby and diamonds to go and see sapphire and diamonds, and I was in a phone booth opposite the Royal Albert Hall. I had my little purse and I put the ring in, took the other ring out, made the phone call, got in a taxi to go to Sapphire and Diamonds. And I suddenly realized I hadn't got my purse. I couldn't pay for the taxi, and the Ruby and Diamonds was in there.
Right.
And it came from Aspreys, I think that was. So Ruby and Diamonds knew about Sapphire and Diamonds, right. But Sapphire and Diamonds didn't know about Ruby and Diamonds. So I told Ruby and Diamonds, I said, I was changing rings. Don't worry, I'll get you another one. He got me another one. And stupidly, I used to occasionally forget to change rings.
Right.
And I'm sitting there with Sapphire and Diamonds, and he'd say, what's that ring?
Oh, no.
And I'd say, oh, well, you know, that friend of mine is going off to the war, and it was his grandmother, and I'm making up this story, and it was his grandmother's ring, and so I'm wearing it while he's away. Well, he swallowed that till I did it the second time.
Oh, no.
And then I had it on. You're wearing that ring again. Oh, I said, no, that's when I told the story.
Right.
So he rang the guy.
Oh, no way.
And he said, yeah, about that ring. I wondered where it came from. So it caps out the bag. And so, oh, the stories about the rings. Do you know, I kept, you know, in those days, men actually wrote love letters.
Sweet,
and
yes.
They were all in different coloured ribbon. I still have them all to this day. And funny enough, Ruby and Diamonds twice. He's now living in Jamaica, and he comes over. He doesn't believe I've got them. Next time he comes over, which will be in about 2 months, I'm going to show him.
Yeah,
I kept everything.
So sweet.
So if we move quickly on.
Yes, we will.
Because unfortunately, these stories, they go off in...
Tell us about Jimi Hendrix. What happened with your contract and with him?
Ah, well, that was during 2 years when, in actual fact, I closed the club because there was this undercurrent going on, which actually led to the revolution eventually. And there was no middle class. You were either very poor or you were very rich in Portugal. So I closed the club, came back to London, and teamed up again with Sapphire and Diamonds. And I said, well, you know, what I can do is if I can get tail end of a lease somewhere, I can open a 7, 7.5, because we had so much publicity and so many followers who loved coming down to the club. I mean, there wasn't an airport there for about another 3 years, but people came by private plane, by private
Amazing.
Yacht, drove down.
Where did the name come from, 7, 7.5?
Well, because I thought it was 7, 7.5. It was actually 6, 6.5 in the street, because I thought it was number 7. It turned out to be number 6. And the half, because the first time the builders put an axe in, the whole place fell down. So they had to rebuild it with reinforced concrete.
Okay.
It took 600 people a night. It was fairly big.
Yeah.
And very big. That's how I met Cliff Richards. He used to come every day and out of the sun, and we'd learn all the current dances.
Right.
And anyway, so Jimi Hendrix.
Yes, Jimi Hendrix.
So what happened was with this club, it's in that, what's it called, this market place, which is behind Curzon Street. I'll think of it in a minute.
Mm-hmm.
Curzon Street in Hyde Park, this is a little area. And there was this one property. It's you can only get in one way and come out. And I took the lease and signed it for, I think, 6 weeks or something. And then needed, I wanted a live musician as well as having a disco.
Yeah.
And this young man came, he just arrived in the country, and he'd brought a single out. And we didn't hear, I think maybe he played the single. And I thought, great. And then he would come and rehearse, and then the opening night. So that would have been, say, a week to 10 days later, and his record went into the charts. Never reached number one, but it got into the charts. And by the time we opened, it was top 20. Word got out, and everyone, and I mean the whole of the Rolling Stones, were queuing up on the stairs. My brother was there queuing up to get in. You could not move. And Shepherd's Market, it was called Shepherd's Market. And of course, the people were all around Shepherd's Market. And the guy who owned the property was so pissed off, nothing he could do. He turned off the electricity.
Mid-evening.
Yeah. He turned off the electricity permanently.
Wow.
And so, and I was too inexperienced and too young to realize he couldn't do that because I had a contract.
Right.
And he might not have liked it, and he could have complained, and maybe we could have restricted the numbers. But
was he annoyed by your success, or just the numbers that it was causing?
The numbers. He didn't like, and there were hundreds
imagine,
of people, hundreds, and literally you couldn't get into the club. They were all grouped on the stairs, and all wearing, in those days, it was the fashion to wear military coats with all the medals. I mean, it was totally inappropriate, but that's what they did. So that's how I met Jimi Hendrix and got to know him. And believe it or not, there were photographs, and they're the one thing I haven't got and can't find. But my brother, who was there, of course, he did a film on Jimi Hendrix, and it's in his film.
Oh,
so he
so
mentioned
good.
It, yeah.
Okay, very
yeah,
nice.
Which is great. Because a lot of people don't know that is a historical fact.
Wow.
Yeah.
Amazing.
Yeah.
So you have quite an eye for talent, I guess.
Talent is something I see, I meet somebody, and you sort of see beyond. Mm. And you realize in the world we live today, it's very difficult. It's very difficult to get onto the first step of a successful ladder. You need help because whatever anybody tells you, you can have talent, but you need the connections. You need the introductions. And when I see something which I know, given a few years, given putting in the right direction, you know that they're going to end up successful. And often I take people like that under my wing. And usually if it works, they remember 10 years down
I'm
the
sure.
line.
Yeah, I'm
with
sure.
people like Ivana Trump.
Yeah,
or
I was
Shirley,
going to say,
yeah.
how did you meet
Ivana
Trump?
She cold called me.
Excellent businesswoman, amazing woman in general.
So that would have been 38 years ago. She literally, she'd been divorced, she got divorced, came to this country, wanted to buy a flat, wanted to have a life here.
Were you by now already known as
I had huge amount of publicity.
Okay.
During COVID, this floor was covered with front covers, 5 pages, you name it, every magazine, every newspaper.
So by your event planning and your etiquette work?
No, it wasn't to do with the etiquette. It was to do with, I suppose I gave a good interview, but I had I had so much publicity.
Right, okay.
And if you amalgamate the fact that I'd been a deb, ran away from home, opened the first discotheque club
amazing,
in Portugal,
launched
all the first clubs in London.
Yeah.
And the various things that I got involved with, and the engagements, and etc.
We haven't talked about the line yet, so I guess that's in there somewhere too.
That's later on.
Yeah,
yeah.
Okay.
And that's more recent because where I'm going, I didn't meet John until the end of the 70s.
Right.
And I was opening a club called Bennett of Battersea. Mm. And Bennett of Battersea, nobody from this side of the river had ventured over to the other side.
We're in Chelsea, just so people know where we
are. Yeah, that's right, from Chelsea. And there was an organization called the Battersea Rehabilitation Action Group.
Right.
And run by a guy who literally you thought was Rasputin.
Right.
He had the flowing locks, he had the flowing cloak, and he had the determination, and he hated anybody this side of the river. And actually, it was my now brother-in-law, Ian Watson, who was in partnership with a man called Pat Doherty. Pat Doherty owns now Titanic Hotels. He opened Titanic Belfast. He owns Carlisle Bay. And so I've known him for 40 years, but I met him because the guy, Ian Watson, was his partner, and I knew him. He later married my sister. And these two had bought properties around Old Battersea Square.
Right.
So this was very much a promotion. So they said, we want, and because I launched most of the clubs in London, the discotheque clubs, as membership clubs. So
yeah.
My forte was putting together the membership. And I did it that way, which I told you, by putting together significant people who would then bring in the right, the people who could afford it, and the people who added personality to what I was creating. And I always remember, so with that particular property, it had a garden, and I needed a garden. And it was derelict, and this property, which you can see now, Bennett of London, it's a famous building. And so I rang Roddy Llewellyn, and Roddy Llewellyn had a landscape gardening business.
Right.
You probably know that Roddy Llewellyn had a relationship with Princess Margaret.
Right.
And but he was just starting the relationship, but I knew him, mm-hmm. and I knew Di Llewellyn, who was in fact one of Tallulah's godparents. And Roddy, what had happened, Di Llewellyn had gone to Australia, had met John Rendell.
Right.
And he, John, on that introduction, had come to this country,
right.
met Roddy. And they went into partnership together in a landscape gardening business. So I said to Roddy, I need you to landscape the garden. I said, in return, and that I can use your relationship with Princess Margaret, I'll make certain you get a percentage of the shares. Done deal. It was done. So it wasn't done underhand. I didn't use Roddy in any way. It was an agreement, which I still have. And because people often think, oh, you know, how does that kind of thing happen? Did she go ahead and do it? Never. I would never do anything like that. I would always get permission. And so with Roddy, first meeting we had, and by that time I got my second property, 180 Kings Road. And I remember thinking I had to go to the architect's office to approve the plans for this garden. And being very correct, I was thinking, now what should I wear to go to the architect's office? I know, I've got that wonderful Jean Muir pale grey blue hot pants in velvet with a matching waistcoat trimmed in brown leather, a matching beret, and my Bieber blue grey stacked heel boots. Perfect to go to an architect's office.
Hot pants?
Yeah. Blue, they were French blue, velvet,
okay.
but the whole thing matched, including the beret.
Yeah.
And I thought, so I'm standing out in the King's Road waiting for Roddy to pick me up
right.
with his partner who I hadn't met. And along comes this dirty old blue van held together with string. And to my horror, and it stops, you know, outside 180 King's Road, Blenheim House. And I'm thinking, I had such a big profile in those days, and I'm thinking, if anybody sees me in my Jean Muir hot pants. And anyway, Roddy jumps out, John gets out, and he says, this is John Rendell, you know, my business partner. And I said, hello, how nice to meet you. And it went, I was so mortified, mortified. Anyway, they get in, I'm in the middle.
Okay.
And Roddy's driving and John's there, and I'm in the middle, horrified. And I'm terrified anybody should recognize me. And we drive, we do the meeting, and I just said, yes, yes, yes. And then Roddy says, oh, by the way, John, will you drive? Because I'm going to Kensington Palace to have lunch with PM, okay. Princess Margaret. And she's dying to meet you. And I said, Roddy, I'm wearing hot pants. I've got boots up to here. There's no way I can go to Kensington Palace to meet Princess Margaret. Yes, 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 you can. Yes, you can. No, 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 I can't. Yes, 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 you can. So John drove to the palace. We get to the palace gate. The police salute him. So we drive in. And Princess Margaret in those days was in the front apartment, which in fact Kate and William had.
Okay.
And it's the best there. And we go in. And just before we go in, Roddy says, by the way, she likes low curtsies. I said, Roddy, I'm not even going to be able to curtsy. I've got boots, I've got hot pants. I know she likes low curtsy. She opens the door and she's holding her glass of gin and cigarette in one hand. She opens the door. Roddy whisks himself in behind her, which she thought was rather strange. And I, Mom, this is Liz Brewer. Oh, she said, I've been dying to meet you.
Oh, sweet.
So I put out my hand, I'm off the top step, and I try, and I'm going, and Roddy is going,
oh, no.
She looks around and sees him, oh, Roddy, naughty boy. And I said, I can't go any lower. That was my first meeting with Princess Margaret. Anyway, we left Roddy, and John took me off to lunch, a little restaurant in the King's Road. It was called Friends, I think it was called. It was quite a well-known restaurant, little restaurant in a basement. And we go there, and he decided that he was going to marry me.
Nice.
And, but I had emeralds.
You had the wrong ring.
Emeralds and diamonds. And emeralds and diamonds, great guy, who I still am in touch with. They all ring me on my birthday. And, which is annoying if you've got the camera on at 1 a.m. in the morning, you know. Or in bed. And so Richard Woodnut. And Richard, I had to give him the ring back. So I had the emerald and diamonds. We then went off to Paris. Roddy was making a record with somebody called Petula Clark. We were all staying at the Ritz together. So I was already sort of having an affair with John, and
sort of,
and well, he had a complicated life, and as did Roddy. Anyway, so the three of us were at the Ritz, and I remember flying back because Roddy, by that time, had a huge profile because of Princess Margaret. When we touched down, landed, all the press were there. And Roddy got off the plane and we're going in and he said, I'm not the story. Liz Brewer, who as you know has been engaged seven times, that's right, is marrying John Rendell because he'd asked me to marry him. He gave me a little gold necklace with a heart.
But no ring.
And a diamond. No, I was bad risk. He wasn't going to give me a ring.
Never, you didn't want to continue the pattern.
Never gave me a ring. And so slap, slap, slap. And then I knew that it would be headlines the following day and Nigel Dempster would do it. And I had to get the ring back. So they were going to this little restaurant, Friends, and with Colin Tennant, a Lady Glen Connors. Mm-hmm. And they were all meeting up. And I said, I tell you what, I'm going to give the ring back and then I'll come and join you. So it was like 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock, and we can celebrate. So I went over to Richard and I said, Richard, I only agreed to marry you if you stop smoking. And he had one lung. And and I knew not, because every time I walk in a room, there's smoke going up behind your back. So there's the ring. And he just sat there and he said, oh, I see. And he hadn't got an argument. Yeah. So that was it. I went back and I walked in and I said, right, I'm free. We can get married. And the following morning, 9 o'clock, the phone goes. And Richard said, not much has surprised me in my life. But I'm eating my boiled eggs with my soldiers, you know. Yeah. And I'm just reading my Daily Mail. And I see you're going to marry John Rendell. Your timing is immaculate. Anyway, we always remain friends, yeah, all of them. Good. I lost one, which was sad. And I don't know what happened to him. But anyway, so that was John Rendell. That's how I met John, yeah, Rendell. And we got married quite quickly because his parents were coming over to this country. He'd had a huge amount of publicity because of his line and the film. Mm. And to be honest, I was slightly unaware of all that until after when I married him, a girl in LA at university was studying instinct.
Right.
And there is a part of that film that the BBC made, which is an hour long,
so called Christian the Lion.
Yes, Christian the Lion.
Did you meet Christian?
No, this was afterwards.
Right, okay.
And so Christian the Lion, and she took a clip out of the original BBC film, which was the reunion, and it proved instinct. Yeah. So when John arrived with Ace, they brought the Lion together. And they arrived to finish the film because, yeah, Christian hadn't been seen for a while and George Adamson was there and they needed to complete the film. And George said, it is extraordinary, but from the moment you touch down, Lions have been seen around the camp.
Wow.
And they hadn't before. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Right. And it was quite extraordinary. So she cut that little film out and put it on YouTube, yeah, which is why to this day it's had more views than any other film.
I think
film
it's been
ever.
The first viral video, yes, ever on YouTube.
It was.
How amazing.
It really
when
was.
When I saw that, was, yeah, a while back, I was like, yeah, tears streaming down my
That's
face.
Right.
It's amazing.
And I knew that John would make the most amazing father, which of course he was. John was sensational. It was the first time in my life I actually had somebody I could rely on because I didn't want to trust anyone to do what I could do myself. It just meant that my time was so valuable, yeah, but I was running out of time all the time. And he was brilliant. Traveling with him was fantastic. He was an amazing father, fantastic, fabulous father. And he also knew how to deal with me, and I was busy, and I was always busy. But he was an incredible father. And of course, Tallulah, who you interviewed, mm-hmm, she really does have the best of John in her, and hopefully the best of me. But with John was happy-go-lucky. So John was not a provider. Mm-hmm. And in the end, you know, he had four polo ponies. I couldn't understand where the money was going. Anyway, John had no idea about money, ever. And we had probably one of the first or only historical divorces where there was one lawyer. Mm-hmm. I said, John, what's yours is yours. What's mine's mine. Mm-hmm. It cost 500 quid. And I gave him a property in around the corner in Lower Belgrave Street. It was a shortish lease. I think it was 20 years. And I said, the income from that, you pay for the school fees, you pay for the nanny, and you pay for Tallulah's clothing, which he honored, which was great. And he moved next door. So you could still do my dress up.
And my ex lived next door to each other as well.
And it just
makes it easy.
But you see, nobody understood that.
I agree, yes. No, my experience is the same.
You know, nobody understands that you can have a relationship,
exactly,
and continue. And people can't say it's always black or white, but it wasn't. Mm-hmm. It really wasn't. And he still used to visit here and try and advise on various things. And he was an amazing man, amazing man.
Yeah, I think it's a good relationship to have. To
yes, honest. Yeah, it was.
So let's go back. Tell us about Ivana Trump.
I got off the subject.
That's okay.
Yeah. So she cold called me. So it would have been, I suppose, the mid-80s and late 80s. And she's just, Avel. Everybody says, I need to meet you. Mm. I said, oh, lovely. We must have the lunch. I said, okay. I remember of Harris Bar, and I knew she'd love it. I said, I'll book at Harris Bar. We'll have lunch there tomorrow. I was fascinated to know what she wanted. She'd made so many mistakes. You know, she was wearing the wrong clothes. She was, you know, if you want a sort of come and live in this country, mm-hmm. the British at that time mm-hmm. Were quite aloof, and it takes time. You know, you can buy a house in a village and you're still the new person after 30 years. Mm. You have to be able to break down the barriers. And so and at that time, I was very much doing that with people who wanted to come here, live in this country, have a successful business, have a successful social life, and be with people that they'd get to know anyway, mm-hmm. but it would take 10, 20 years. Right. And you could be a member of the clubs. So I used to do the shortcuts. Right. And one of the ways was always to get me involved in a worthwhile charity with hopefully perhaps a royal involved. And so they could establish themselves and understand how this country sort of works. Mm. And whatever anybody might say, and I think to this day it's still almost true, it's who you know. It's yeah. contacts. Yeah. It's contacts, and it's actually, you know, working hard to achieve something. You have to focus mm-hmm. in life. And I'm a great believer, when you focus on something, what happens is everything starts going in that mm-hmm. same direction. Your energy goes yeah. in that direction. Every time anybody calls you, you're thinking about that, and somehow or other, things fall into place. But it's a question of focusing. Mm. And yes, if anybody ever wanted advice, if you want something hard enough, if you start focusing on it, more than likely you'll get it. But you have to be aware that if and when you get it, it's what you really want.
Yeah. So always be careful what you wish for, right?
That's right.
Because you might get it.
Well, more than likely yeah. you will get yeah. it. And the problem is, once in my life, there was something I wanted, and it involved a person. And I think I hurt that person, and I may have even destroyed part of their life. Because when I got what I wanted, I suddenly realized it's not what I want.
Right.
It was absolutely not right for me.
Okay.
And it was a lesson learned. Mm. But I do know that, and funnily enough, when that photograph was taken.
Yes. Talk us through your aura.
Oh, my
Liz.
Aura, yeah. I was at Chiva Som in Thailand, and I was with Mark.
So the aura is yellow for all those viewers and listeners.
Yeah, it's sort of gold. I mean,
sort of gold.
It's
yeah,
sort of gold.
Right. Okay.
It's extraordinary. I always thought it was the champagne. No, you're right. It's sort of
yellow. A little bit red.
It's extraordinary.
Oh, I didn't know
anything about auras. And I'm at this.
I didn't know they were that big. I thought it was much smaller, actually.
Well, yes, because you're probably aware that leaves and flowers and trees yeah. all have an aura.
Correct,
and
yeah.
there's a special camera called a Corallian camera,
right.
which photographs auras. And if you look that up, you'll see leaves and trees, and you'll see the energy around them
right.
photographed. What this wise man who came to Shiva Som, and I was there coincidentally with Mark Burley, who started Annabelle's and the Burley Group, and he had the beginnings of his illness. Mm. It was Mark Burley, there was Evelyn de Rothschild, there was two other people that I knew well, Andrew de Candle, and there was Joseph Allo. And these significant men. And we'd been out to dinner the night before. And Shiva Som, is a huge retreat, and you're cleaning out, and you're being really good. And I always remember the first night I'm there, the first morning I'm there, and I go to have my little breakfast, and I'm going to finish my first book. And I'm sitting there, and I hear this voice. All I want is a plain English cup of tea. And I recognized, I said, Mark, and there was Mark Burley. And so we ganged up, and he was there with Evelyn, and we went out to dinner. And we had a couple of bottles of champagne, which we shouldn't have done because you're sort
like
of
a champagne aura, maybe.
Yeah, that's what I thought, and it was so extraordinary. Yeah. And because I had a bit of a hangover, and I'm there with these four men, and you're summoned to go in to have your aura photographed, and you hold on to two prongs. And I'm thinking, oh God, I feel so terrible. And I'm thinking positive thoughts. And so I'm thinking really positively. And then join the others. And I'm sitting there, they'd all had it done. And out comes this wise old man. And he was Chinese or I don't know. And he comes out with his entourage and he's holding my photograph. And he says, Elizabeth Brewer. I said, yeah, you have a most interesting aura. Come with me. So I promise you, I flew. These four guys and I fly out after this wise old man. And he sits me down and he starts to tell me things that I knew, but I would never admit to. And he said, you have the power of persuasion. Mm-hmm. Don't always use it to your own advantage. And they were very wise words because often if you think I can persuade somebody to do something, you might often think, I want him to do that because I want, I want. And you have to occasionally hold back on that. And he told me that, how does he know? Mm. And in many things he told me. And then I went out and Mark Burley.
Like what, for example? Like what, for example?
And Mark Burley, he had his photograph and there was Mark and it was all purple and black. Well, he had the beginnings of the disease which finally killed him.
Oh, wow.
And he, of course, as you know, started Annabelle's and the Burley Group, which was bought by Richard Caring. And it was sad. That was the beginning. Wow. He was still fine, upright, but he had this problem. And he had all these little needles stuck in his back when I saw him at breakfast. He was shirtless and it was quite extraordinary. But that's the story of that. So I learnt about auras. And having done the Nine Gates Mystery School, children see auras until they're a certain age.
Yeah, amazing.
And then they no longer do, which is sad. And that's why if you see pictures of angels, they have a sort of halo around them.
Do.
It's an aura.
Mm.
And if you Google and research, you'll find that this special camera and you'll see the photographs it takes. And it is extraordinary. It is extraordinary. But when you start understanding about auras, you feel energy.
I was going to say, is this what we feel between people?
Yes. And that's why they use me for certain companies. One client, Finito, if they take young people from university on the first rung of the business ladder, the working ladder, and they'd have to be shown how to walk into a room, how to do an interview. And it's all a question of when I was doing, I did 6 years with ITV, Ladette to Lady. And one of the classes was to literally take those girls and I'd say, I want each one of you to come in feeling something different. It can be anger, it can be jealousy, it can be envy, it can be love, whatever. And the girls are going to try and guess. It took time, but eventually they got it. And it was fascinating. With energy, when you walk in a room, you have to ask, what is it that makes that panel make an instant decision? Which they do. Mm-hmm. They can either think, I like them, I don't like them, well, let's see what they've got to say. But they make a decision.
I always thought that was interesting. Yeah.
And that is the aura. That is the energy around that person. And that aura goes... And it's why for years, I would say, before COVID, people felt they had the right they'd met you for 5 minutes, that they could kiss you on both cheeks.
Right.
It's totally wrong. Your energy needs to feel comfortable with another person's.
Yeah.
With some people, it's instant. Mm. With others, it can take hours, days, sometimes never.
So do you believe that opposites attract? Or does similarity attract?
Anything can attract. Hmm. Anything can attract. It's to do with the right energy.
Right.
And if the energy works out, and I can read energy, and it gives you a terrible advantage sometimes, because you be with somebody and they don't know.
Yeah.
They don't understand why you might be you're on a similar wavelength.
Mm.
And with relationships, it is to do with energy. And with some energy, it's huge.
Yeah.
I mean, it's like your heart pounds.
Yeah.
And I always remember with one particular person who I didn't get engaged to, but I was going to marry, which is why there were more than six ex-fiancés. And Graham, who sadly crashed his plane in Africa and died, was tragic. And he had a golden aura. I mean, from the moment I met him, it was the thunderbolt. It doesn't happen very often with people. That was actually, to be honest, I think it was the only, may have been one other occasion, but I remember significantly that occasion, and it never happened to me before. It was the first, and so it was tragic, yes. And I'd already, John and I were already, he was living next door, and we hadn't divorced then, but it was interesting with that particular person. So I understood about energy and how to connect with people. And Ivana Trump had the ability to not just connect with people, but total focus. So that's what was her secret.
Yeah.
If she's sitting with a man, she was beautiful.
Mm.
Before she had all the work done, she was so stunning. And she would give them their total attention. There would be nobody else in the room.
Mm.
And the guy would be totally smitten, and because he would feel he was the only person in the room, and she could draw him out and have a conversation, and she only focused on him. It was her secret. She could do it to anyone. Extraordinary.
I could feel your energy change when you were saying that as well,
actually.
Liz, you seem very upbeat, and it kind of seems that your life has been and quite an upward trajectory, and things have been panning out for you quite nicely, which is great. Has there ever been a time where it wasn't like that, where maybe you went through something
kind
of challenging in life?
The only time was,
how did you deal with that?
Yeah, I do wake up wanting to get out of bed, wanting to start my day. And I do have a green smoothie every morning.
Okay.
And I have done for 15, 20 years, which I make in my with my magic mixer there, and it is everything that you need.
Right.
And when I'm traveling, I take the powder, green powder, but it's not quite the same. But at least I have that, because when I don't, my energy level drops, and I have ridiculous energy.
Right.
I mean, absurd energy, and really do. And for me to actually feel tired is a luxury which I hardly ever have. But when it happens, and it sometimes happens if I'm totally cut off, with my sister and brother-in-law lucky enough to live on an island when they're not in London, in British Columbia. And when I wrote my second book, and I'm staying with them, they'd have to drag me in to eat. Because it's total focus. And once you, if you've ever written a book, once you leave writing and eat or what, you lose the train of thought,
for sure.
And you have to reread, and then you start editing, and you never stop editing.
I did it right at the end. I thought, let me write it first and then edit, because otherwise you get
that's
caught in it too much.
And so it's fascinating. So I think one of the real the two low moments of my life was death. I had, we're not educated about death. Death is something which comes and happens, and you're never quite ready for it. So when my father died, for me, and I was in the middle of doing a huge launch, and I remember going home, and my father died of cancer, and I saw the deterioration. When you see somebody who, you know, you've always looked up to, fantastic man, and then you see, the thing about death is it can be so humiliating and so degrading, and the way people crumble, that saddened me, and I wasn't ready for it, and I certainly wasn't ready for it when my mother died, which is now 20 years ago, and it was terrible. There's nothing you can do about it, and you have to accept it. But, you know, a day doesn't go by when you're still not thinking about them. And so that, and of course, when I was in LA, no, I was in San Francisco, when I got a phone call to tell me that Graham had crashed his plane and died. Well, the trouble is with that, you don't have closure. And you don't see them ill, you don't see them injured, you don't see them die. And therefore, you often think they're around a corner. You don't get the closure. And I'm not quite sure which is worse, because he was an amazing man. He was an extraordinary man. And yeah, and I was most definitely in love with him. And that's another thing which is so strange. What is it that makes you fall in love?
It's so interesting, I agree.
And it is fascinating. And I think I finally, it's taken me a long, long time.
Let's share this, Liz. Yeah, what makes someone fall in love?
I think it's to do with, it's definitely to do with the aura and the energy. And the two auras doing something that we're not still quite aware of. I think they're more aware in the East. But it's also to do with feeling a protection, feeling a communication, feeling something which is different that makes your heart pound. Every time I would drive over, he had a house in London, he had a fabulous place in South Africa and in Africa. But my heart would pound driving over. I know if I'm attracted to someone, I get that feeling. It's a feeling of excitement. It's everything is, as I say, focuses on that person. Everything you're doing and thinking about starts to focus on that person. Why and how? It's something to do with the electricity. It's something to do with, as I say, the energy around us. And that energy is more powerful than we are, and it controls us. And I think people don't understand that. You see, falling in love is not just having good sex. It's a bonus. But it's not to do with that. I mean, it's to do with actually focusing on somebody, and they're in your thoughts every time you're doing something, whatever you're thinking about, the fact you're going to see them. It's an excitement, but it's to do with something that is working inside us, and it's a sort of like a current.
Yeah, and I find that even if they're away and abroad, that you can still feel them.
You do. And it's like when the phone goes and you know.
Yeah, that's who it is.
And some of the time you even know what they're thinking, or you know what they're going to do. And it's a question of being totally in touch.
It's amazing. It's great to find people like that.
Yeah, you're in touch with your own trigger points, as it were, and your own feelings. But a lot of people never discover that, and it's a shame. So they interpret being in love in a different way, which doesn't work. I mean, you can be in, it's like with friends. I have friends all through my life and who I keep up with. And it doesn't matter, I may not have seen them 10, 20 years.
And it's exactly the same, isn't it, when you
see them? And then you see them and it's exactly the same. And I have other friends that occasionally I need to push aside and separate. Maybe they don't put a value on the friendship, and I need them to learn about what our friendship is about and to put a value on it. Because, you know, I have an awful lot of friends, And I don't want to waste time if somebody doesn't put a value on the friendship. So it's such an interesting subject, and it's something that we're not taught.
True.
It's something we grow up seeing, hopefully with our parents or siblings. Mm. You know, you love your brothers and your sisters, you love your relations, because that's a duty, that's what you are used to. But with matters of the heart, when you have that feeling, and there is a feeling, and it is, as all I can say, it's something that happens within our makeup and within our energy.
Yeah, I agree. Do you think that maybe you have to be open to that and actually accept it and dare to go with that?
Well, that's why I think
I think a lot of people just close it down and they don't dare to go, because it's quite wild and it's quite...
Yes, but then that's what I started off.
Encompassing, I think.
I started telling you about Nine Gates Mystery School. And so there is that process, and I was half open.
Right.
So you do the first bit, and I think it's 3 weeks, and you go through an extraordinary process. Mm. So they open your chakras, and then you're half open. And then they say, off you go. And then you come back. I think it was after 2 months or 3 months, I can't remember, to be honest. And then you go back, and then they open you up. Mm. They open your heart, so they open your head, and your head, till you're connected right up there. It's the most extraordinary process, and you are so alive and open. Nobody can get one over you, I can assure you. It's quite extraordinary. I will tell you one thing, which I shouldn't, but I've told other people. The first night, they wake you up, and you have to drink your own pee.
Wow.
It was wow.
Wow.
I couldn't believe it. And everything that you go through...
So what is the purpose of that?
To open your chakras. It's to open your chakras. Wow. And it is. You need to Google it or to study it to understand.
Yeah.
But you have a total awareness of the world.
Wow.
And you see things, and maybe it brings out more of a sense of humor. Mm. Maybe it brings out a way of looking at life where you can still get rattled and pissed off with people. Mm. But at the same time, there is a joie de vivre. There is an understanding about why we're here and the purpose of being here and what makes people happy and what makes you happy. And in life, it's all about either spreading some good in the world and feeling good about it and being happy and giving happiness and laughing, you know, and having joie de vivre.
Yeah.
And if that happens to be singing, in Tallulah's case, or in dancing, or laughing, or drinking vodka, so be it.
Liz, thank you so much. I think we're going to leave it with that thought, that drinking vodka sometimes is okay.
Of course it is.
Thank you so much for being my wonderful guest.
Not at all.
And also the last guest for this season.
I know, so. I'm so flattered.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. No, not at all. I look forward to seeing you.
Amazing.